Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Q1 FY22 earnings conference call of Inox Leisure Limited, hosted by ICICI Securities Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Sanjay Jain from ICICI Securities Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Rituja. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us on Inox Leisure Limited's Quarter 1 FY22 results conference call. Today we have with us Mr. Alok Tandon, Chief Executive Officer, and Mr. Kailash Gupta, Chief Financial Officer, Inox Leisure Limited. I would like to invite Mr. Alok Tandon to initiate the proceeding with his opening remarks, post which we will have a session on Q&A. Thank you. Over to you, Alok sir.
Thank you, Sanjay. A very good evening to all of you. I am Alok Tandon, and with me is my colleague, Mr. Kailash Gupta, who is the CFO of the company. On behalf of the management of Inox Leisure Limited, I welcome you all on this call. Our board has approved the quarterly result for Q1 FY22, and the same has been uploaded on the website of the stock exchanges and also on the company's website. The quarter not only continued to test us, but also our resilience and our ability to face headwinds. We have stood tall to all the adversities that we have faced in the past 6 quarters. And so we look at Q2 FY22 as the point from where the turnaround should begin. We continue to remain inspired by our robust fundamentals, strong liquidity position, the infinite passion, and above all, a great team which has shown tremendous fighting spirit and innovativeness in helping the company not only to sail through these difficult times, but also emerge stronger, sharper, and fitter. All I can say is that the team is roaring and raring to go with the same level of zeal that it possessed 6 quarters back when the ship was sailing fast and steady. We know that there is a lot to look forward to in terms of resuming cinema operations across the country, ensuring a safe and a hygienic cinema experience, laying out the fascinating content that is in store, curating innovative delights for our guests, and rolling out an all-new F&B roadmap for the company. What gives us a lot of hope is the fact that our consumers and our teams are much more comfortable and familiar with the new normal, as is evident with the performance of cinemas in global markets where operations have begun. With a lot of positivity, optimism, and excitement, we are setting ourselves up for hopefully the last leg of this tumultuous COVID journey and look forward to a brighter and a happier future for our customers, our stakeholders, and our biggest assets, our people. Let me take you through the presentation. The key highlights are as follows. Inox has successfully raised 300 crores through a QIP in June 2021. Even during these tough times, Inox consistently had a strong liquidity position, and we are the only national chain that is net debt-free. During the second wave, we took the initiative to ensure that all our employees are vaccinated against COVID-19. I feel proud to say that today, 100% of our employees are vaccinated from this deadly virus. Let us now look at some of the financial highlights of Q1 FY22. As you all know, due to the second wave of COVID-19, cinemas were advised to close down by the respective state governments in a staggered manner, starting from mid of April 2022 this year. And also, we had shut down from late March 2020 last year. As a result, our financial and operating performances were severely impacted. For Q1 FY22, the revenue was 26 crores as compared to 3 crores in Q1 FY21. Q1 FY21 figures are skewed as cinemas were totally shut due to COVID-19 lockdown. EBITDA was at a negative 104 crore rupees as compared to a negative 35 crore rupees in Q1 FY21. PAT was at a negative 101 crore rupees for this quarter as compared to negative 52 crore rupees in Q1 FY21. Performance in our key operational metrics were as follows. In Q1 FY22, the footfalls were only 8.25 lakhs. And as I mentioned, that there are no corresponding operational figures in Q1 FY21 as the cinemas were shut due to COVID-19 lockdown. In Q1 FY22, occupancy was at 12%, ATP at 173 rupees, and SPH at 78 rupees. As there was an impact on revenues during Q1 FY22 due to the second wave of COVID-19, we have tried our best to keep our fixed costs under control. However, year-on-year comparison of Q1 FY22 with Q1 FY21 could be skewed as Q1 FY21 was a complete shutdown. We can see that from the numbers. On a quarter-on-quarter basis, our employee benefit expense, including agency manpower, has gone down from 37 crores in Q4 FY21 to 27.1 crores in this quarter. Power and fuel and R&M expenses have decreased from 24.1 crore rupees in Q4 FY21 to 10.1 crore rupees in this quarter. Our expense towards rent and CAM during Q1 FY22 was 74 crores. During the second wave of COVID-19, we have renegotiated rent and CAM in nearly 65% of our properties. Rent and CAM for Q1 FY22 includes rebate and concessionals and concessions gained from negotiations that were settled with the landlords during Q1 FY22. And for the rest of the ongoing negotiations, we have considered full rent and CAM as per agreement. We have also reduced our other overheads in this quarter from 20.5 crore rupees in Q4 FY21 to 10.7 crores in Q1 FY22. Currently, as we speak, 13 states and one union territory where INOX is present have allowed us to open our cinemas. Most of the states have a seating capacity restriction of 50%. 5 states have yet to come out with an order to allow cinemas to open for business. In terms of shareholding structure, as on 30th of July 2021, FIIs owned about 16.23% of the company. The DIIs owned about 23.18%, promoter and promoter group hold 43.63%, and public and others own 16.96% of the company. The share price as on 30th of July 2021 was 325.60 rupees, which gives the company a market capitalization of approximately 4,000 crore rupees. In April 2021, we opened SBR Horizon Bangalore with 5 screens and 694 seats. Based on the agreements already signed, I feel proud to share that beyond FY22, we have properties signed up to the extent of nearly 133 more properties, 926 more screens, with an addition of another 171,675 seats. And once this entire pipeline is fully implemented, we will have 296 properties, 1,618 screens, and nearly 327,000 seats. At present, we are operational in 18 states and one union territory, present in 69 cities, with 153 properties and 648 screens. The 8.25 lakh footfall which I talked about in Q1 FY22 was mostly due to the release of Wild Dog, which is a Telugu movie, Sultan, which is a Tamil movie, Karnan, again, which was in Tamil, Vakil Saab, which was in Telugu. Post-novelty from the second wave, multiplexes do have a healthy lineup of movies, wherein Hindi, English, and there are movies also in other Indian languages. Well, if I look at the movie lineup, I think it's mouth-watering. And in Hindi, we have movies like Bell Bottom, Satyamev Jayate, Surya Vanshi, Shamshera, Prithvi Raj, Lal Singh Chadda, just to name a few. If I talk about movies in other Indian languages, we have RRR, KGF2, Pushpa, Radhe Shyam, and many more to come. And English is not far behind with F9, The Fast Saga, The Conjuring, Devil Made Me Do It, Jungle Cruise, Suicide Squad, Spider-Man, and the list is endless. Another important set of stakeholders for us are the content partners, and we have been in constant dialogue with them. Due to the second wave, producers and distributors have deferred their movie releases, and majority of the producers and distributors are in favor of releasing their movies on the big screen. As mentioned earlier, we have a very healthy lineup of movies to show once normalcy returns. As far as CapEx is concerned, we have 19 screens wherein 90% of the work has been completed, hence would require an additional CapEx of anything between 8 to 10 crore rupees. And we may open or invest in another 25 screens, but all that depends on the normalization process and how the movies do well. And for those 25 screens, we would require an additional 65 crore rupees. I would also like to reiterate that our liquidity position is very strong. As on July 31st, 2021, we have liquidity of close to 400 crore rupees, which includes an undrawn limit of 120 crore rupees. Alternatively, Inox owns 6 cinema properties and a head office. As per the market valuation, if required, we can raise close to 350 crores by doing a sale and a lease back of these properties. As on July 31st, 2021, our gross debt is 117 crores. Well, gentlemen, this was a brief about the quarter which has gone by, and with that, Kailash and I would like to open this up for any question and answers that you may have.
Thank you very much. So we'll now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Amrita Sai Krista from Edelweiss Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks. This is Abneesh here from Edelweiss. My first question is, Mumbai and Maharashtra still have not opened up. So do you see any risk to the release date of Bell Bottom, given it's a large and big budget movie, and you will need 1 to 2 weeks for marketing or any movie, other than the industry will be. So isn't that looking at risk from a release date perspective, current release date?
Well, you're right, Abneesh, that Mumbai and Maharashtra have not allowed us to open. And, well, we were also shocked that we have not been allowed to open, though we were expecting that yesterday when the circular came out that the multiplexes and cinema halls in Maharashtra would be allowed to operate, but that's not the case. Whatever we have heard, Abneesh, is that the producers will go ahead with the release date and they will not wait for Maharashtra to open. So that's what we have heard, but they'll be the right people to answer the question, the producers. But we feel that they have announced the movie in any case, and they should be releasing it on 19th of August with or Maharashtra, with or without Maharashtra allowing the opening of the cinema halls.
Second is, how would you deal with the hesitation of consumer to come to the screen, given there was a recent survey which said that few customers want to go to multiplex or cinema theater in the air condition environment. So I've seen CDR come out with promos on buy one, get one offer, etc. on F&B if consumer is vaccinated. So if you could talk about what are your plans and how do you see consumer coming back in the next 1-2 months? When do you see peak coming back? Of course, on the presumption that there is no wave season, no one knows about it, so let's take that hypothesis.
Well, let me tell you that We know that consumers are going to rely on brands that they trust in the post-pandemic era. And that is where our hard work put in by our teams will come into play, Abneesh. We at Inox have laid a lot of focus on hygiene and sanitization of our cinemas. We have invested a lot of time in training and awareness about the new normal, only to ensure that our cinemas remain the safest public places. How I look at it, Abneesh, is that our marketing team will also come up with various, I would say, incentives to tell people and tell them that you please come to Inox and ours is a safe cinema. But having said this, one has to do a lot to convince guests to come back, and which can be demonstrated by keeping your properties neat and clean, by ensuring that adequate fresh air is pumped in, by ensuring that all these seats and all the public areas are cleaned and sanitized after every show. So one has to literally win back the customer confidence when they come into your properties. We too will come up with various incentives for our guests, and our marketing team is working on how to make them, I would say the first priority is make them happy, safe, and then we are looking at offers of a popcorn or a BOGO or any other thing which can incentivize them to come to the multiplex.
So, last question. So, what has been the initial response where things opened up? These early days and content itself may be limited. Plus, on the 100% allowance by one or two states, what is the thought process you're getting? Will the 100% allowance be much faster this time? Last time it was slow, but this time we are. Quite surprising that one or two states are already allowed 100%
Well, last Friday there was a Telugu movie which released, and we can say that we had houseful shows. And when I say houseful, Abneesh means wherever the state government has allowed us to open with 50% capacity, every alternate seat was full. And where we were allowed to operate with 100% capacity, the entire auditorium was chock-a-block. Yes. We followed all safety protocols as advised by the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting and various state governments. But people want to come out. People want to breathe differently. And for them, sitting at home for the last 14, 15 months, I think, has taken its toll. And there's a lot of pent-up demand for people to come, enjoy themselves, and watch a movie on the large screen. So the weekend has been heartening, and we have seen some great footfalls across the country.
Okay, and you expect states to allow 100% much earlier this time?
Well, that all depends on the state, Abneesh. We are requesting all the state governments that as we are COVID compliant, we are following all safety precautions, please allow 100% capacity. But that's for them to decide. But our only request to them is that it should be done sooner rather than later.
Yeah. That's all from my side. Thanks and all that.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jinesh Joshi from Prabhudas Lilladher Private Limited. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. Sir, I have a question on reopening. With Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu yet to open, probably the big budget releases might take longer to release. Although you mentioned that Bell Bottom might go ahead with its release date of 19th August. Probably that can be an exception, but taking this into account that the releases might take some time, do we plan to open our properties in the geographies where we have the permission? Because in absence of big releases, revenue accretion from these properties will be minimal, but the fixed cost from reopening will start hitting our P&L. So just wanted to know, how do we plan to approach the reopening this time?
Well, we all are waiting for Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu to allow. Yes, you're right that these are big states and they give us a lot of revenue. But wherever states have allowed us to open, we should open, because number one, as I said earlier, that the customers have to come back to the cinema halls, and whatever we are showing today is getting good traction. We have to also win back their confidence. That's number two. And as of now, Bell Bottom is coming on 19th of August, and what I've been told that the trailer is being released today. that's another third point, which is a very important point. But the flow of movie is there. If I look at the Suicide Squad, that's coming on 5th August. Conjuring should be released on 13th August. F9, Fast Saga, 19th August. Reminiscence, 27th August. So I feel that the content is there. And once we exhibitors open our screens, once the state governments allow us to operate, there will be lots of producers who will announce their movies. And then there will be a great flow starting, I would say, from the next 2 to 3 weeks. There will be great movies coming out week after week.
Sure, sir. And in the presentation, we have stated that we have permission to open 459 screens. How many have we opened at this point in time?
As we speak, about 201 screens we have opened. These are which are programmed, because the issue is that the content to show is not as we would like to have as of today. So it's about 201 screens that we are operating with. This was yesterday. Today we've added more screens. So we'll come to know the actual count tomorrow morning, but nothing less than 201.
Okay, sir. One last question. Is it possible to kind of share how much do Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu typically contribute from a collection standpoint at the industry level on a pre-COVID basis? Any rough cut figure you'd like to give out?
It all depends on the language, on the genre of the movie. But if I look at Hindi, the entire pie of Maharashtra would be about 20 to 22%.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankur Periwal from Axis Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. So first question on our monthly cash burn. We have been pretty strict in terms of our cost control, the last few quarters. So any thoughts there, with the new streams coming up and, given that you also suggested that we will be opening up screens across the locations wherever there is a permission, whether the content be there or not. So any sense you can help on the cash burn side on the monthly basis?
Well, Ankur, we are looking at the cash burn as if it was Q1 of FY21, as if it's total lockdown. So whether it is our maintenance, whether it is manpower, whether it is heat, light, and power, we are looking at every expense with a fine-tooth comb and trying to curtail whatever we can as of today. When I said that we will be opening everywhere, yes, we will be opening all properties, but depending on the flow of movies, we'll be adding more screens in those particular properties. For example, if there's a 7-screener, we may have content as of today to show only in 3 or 4 screens. But going forward, as the content pipeline improves, we'll be adding more screens. So we are trying to control costs in different ways, in different properties and different geographies. So, but let me assure everyone that our focus on cost cutting is there, and we are trying to burn as little money as possible month on month.
Sure, sir. That's helpful. Secondly, on the digital side and on the newer initiatives, which you had alluded to in the earlier quarters in terms of, F&B sales, etc. If you can highlight, what all initiatives, we are trying to push forward there.
Well, again, so let me tell you, nothing happened in Q1. Whether it was the digital initiatives or having different formats of screens, that will continue once we reopen. Where F&B is concerned, yes, our focus is big time on F&B. Whether it's having or re-engineering the menu, whether it's having new food items, whether it's a partnership with aggregators so that Inox Food could reach the comforts of their house, we are working on all of those parameters, and sooner than later, as soon as we open, we should roll out the entire F&B plan, and that's what the plan is.
Sure, and just a bit on the digital side, which you alluded to, the online ticketing or app-based sort of, subscription, etc. Are we planning to implement, those initiatives as a permanent feature, or probably, we'll take a call as screens open up and basis that we sort of,
Are you referring to the loyalty program? Because app-based ticketing is...
Both. Yeah, exactly. Loyalty as well as, you know, the initiatives that we have taken earlier. Yeah.
Well, I would say that they are on track. And I can say that even when we were shut down, we had lots of members who became, or lots of people who became members of our loyalty program by just enrolling and writing their name and adding a few other points as required in that sheet to become INOX members. So that was a very, very positive and a very heartening sign. Going forward, our loyalty program will continue. The incentives we give to our guests will continue. And also, while there'll be a lot of, I would say, incentive for guests if they book tickets through the website, the INOX app, and even while going forward, our INOX app will be used a lot to order food also. So it's a, I would say, 360 degree effort which we are having to use technology to the hilt, whether our website, whether on our app, or via the loyalty program. So all those endeavors and all our plans will continue going forward, Ankur.
Great, sir. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vikram Ramalingam from Maybank. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you so much for the opportunity. My first question is there a government directive or an initiative from INOX to insist or ask for your patrons' COVID certificate, in the sense vaccination certificate? Will you be doing that? Or
see, we want our patrons and our staff and our employees and our vendors to be absolutely safe. So we will do whatever the government tells us to do, whether it's the central government or the state government. There are few state governments which have told us that we have to check the COVID certificate of people who enter our premises, and we are doing that. There are other places where they are silent, but what we are doing is that we are ensuring and following all safety, COVID safety protocols. So all those things we are doing. When you say that anything which INOX has done with the state government, I would say that whether it's INOX or the Multiplex Association of India, we, before the first lockdown or during the lockdown and before it was lifted, we sat with the governments of various states and the center and discussed the way forward by coming up with various SOPs. And that is something which was implemented by the governments and we are following it to the T. So whether it's INOX or whether the Multiplex Association of India, we have been quite, I would say, forthcoming, and we have taken the lead in designing SOPs that could be followed and which are safe for our team members, our vendors, and our guests who come into our theatres.
Right. Fair enough. Thank you. My second question is more along the lines of an observation that some of the movies which have gone for a direct OTT release, like Radhe and even couple of other reasonably medium or big ticket movies, we somehow don't see the revenue or box office collections in their case being disclosed in public. And I presume, sir, that would be a challenge for producers as well, because they'll not be able to determine how much they should be or how much of the how much they are entitled to get. So in your conversations with film producers, do you think this is one of those challenges, and are there any other challenges other than the financial part? So I understand the part wherein box office collections obviously will be the bulk of their collections. But do you think there are any other issues that film producers face with direct OTT release?
Well, I think the right people to answer that question are the film producers, but I am a public in this, as you use that word, so we will not come to know the number of people who have watched the movie or the amount of money which has the producer has got. The producer is the only person who knows both. That's what I presume, that how many eyeballs have watched the movie, and number two, what money he's received. But for others, no one knows that. What is the amount of money which has been earned by the producer, or how many people have watched the movie? So for me, even though we are a part of an exhibition group, we are not privy to those numbers at all.
All right. Thank you so much. That's it from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Harit from Investec. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, good evening. So first question was on this rent and CAM number. So, you know, you've seen a sequential increase in the rent and CAM in quarter four to quarter one. My assumption would have been that, you know, this number would have been a bit lower given the fact that you've had some successful renegotiation. So could you just take me through what's happened and, how are you seeing it now as the quarter ended or in July?
Well, we are still in talks with our various partners. And as you said, the 65% of our properties, the rent and CAM has been closed and the issue is sorted out. But for the remaining, we are in talks with them. And I would say that we'll have a clear picture in the next coming week that where we are, where rent and CAM is concerned. But I'm very hopeful that it will be quite favorable as whatever we have got from the 65% partners of ours whom we have already concluded the negotiations, with the remaining also, we'll be able to do it in the same lines.
Okay. Got it. So the benefits of, say, this balance 35%, where you said that in quarter one you booked the entire rent, you could see some of those benefits coming in into quarter two if you have successful negotiations with them?
Yes, that's right.
Okay, got it. The second part was on, just on the year and, obviously quarter one, you've done an extremely good job on restricting losses. I just wanted to get a sense of, as we go through month on month, year on year, especially through fiscal year 22, do we believe that Q1 is probably the peak of challenges in terms of losses for the business? And as Q2 kind of moves forward, barring any third wave impact, these losses should only keep shrinking and probably, turn green as, you turn into third quarter and towards the end of it?
No, you're absolutely right. That's why in my opening statement I said that Q2 onwards, things should turn around and things should improve only, going ahead only from here. So S2 should be great for us because of the lineup we have, because of the, whether it's Hindi, English, or any other language. And I feel that we are now turning the tide and we'll have some great months going forward.
Got it. And last question was, on the Hollywood, precedence over the last, say, 2-3 months. Obviously, from a cinema perspective, you've seen month-on-month box office collections increasing. But if you look at what's happened at the OTT side, you've seen some of the producers who are also studios who also own OTTs. They have done some simultaneous releases. However, it seems like in certain cases there are significant backlashes on that, and now it's not as the number of films that are going through this route there have reduced. So, just wanted your view on how are you seeing it? Do you see a kind of a mean reversion, of the industry even in Hollywood, and that should flow through all other markets as well?
Well, I think, and I always believe that the windowing should be preserved, and that's a globally expected norm that there should be a time lag between a picture hitting the screen and it coming on any other platform. And that, I think, is a fundamental aspect of the entire cinema value chain. Well, let me also tell you that the windowing pattern has done wonders in terms of revenues for the content creators and other stakeholders, as it offers the creator an opportunity to extract the best from the available mediums, whether it is cinema, OTT, or satellite. And let's also not forget that a good theatrical run literally enhances the brand equity and therefore allows content creators to command higher values for their subsequent platforms. Yes, there have been a few people, for example, Black Widow, Jungle Cruise, who have had late release. And from press support, they've heard that those movies could have earned substantially more if they had come on theaters first and then come on an OTT. And I think that literally corroborates with the fact that it's very important for the content to have a good windowing so that a producer or a distributor can exploit maximum from all verticals where the movie is released.
Very clear.
Yeah.
Thanks and all the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Girish Pai from Nirmal Bang Equities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. I just had a question on this theatrical and OTT related subject. With possibly all big movies having some kind of OTT tie-up, do you think the producers have committed to certain OTT dates, release dates, which are inflexible, which irrespective of what happens, whether there is a theatrical release or not, there is going to be an OTT release that's going to happen on a specific date? Or are they sequencing it in such a way that there has to be a theatrical release first before they go to OTT?
See, again, as I said, I will not be able to answer that question. You should ask that to a producer or the content creator, because we are really not privy to the contracts which the producers have with various online platforms. So we really don't know whether there's a fixed date or whether it's a moving date, and the OTT platform guys have told them that no, first it has to be released on a theater and then only it can come on a platform. So I will really not be able to comment on that.
Okay, my second question is on these rental renegotiations. You mentioned that you've got some concessions, at least for the 65% of the circuit. Can you kind of indicate what those concessions are? And secondly, in the rent, in the new renewals that are happening, are you negotiating the commercial structure in a different way compared to what you did previously?
Well, answering your first question, the concessions we have got that we've been able to get revenue share in a lot of properties, and wherever we had a minimum guarantee, that has been drastically reduced. So that's one. Going forward, well, we have not signed any new deal in the last couple of months, but going forward, I think it will be beneficial for both the cinema operator as well as the owner to have a higher portion of revenue share, and a minimum guarantee should be slightly less, but that's going forward. I can't comment on it until we sign a few properties. Whatever we have signed today is there with us, and as we said that once there was a lockdown in phase one and phase two, that's the time when we got help from our partners, our developers, it was nice that we got rev share or a reduced MG in, I would say, nearly all the properties, and that will continue going forward.
My last question is with regard to support from the government, be it the center or the states. This industry has kind of been hit quite hard. Have you heard anything from either the center or the states regarding any concessions, be it on the taxation side or any fixed charges side being waived off for film exhibitors?
Well, we have given representations to various state governments, and Gujarat has waived off the minimum demand for electricity and also on property tax. So there they have come forward, and we are hopeful that other states will also follow, and we should get some rebate from the state governments where we operate.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Anurag Dayal from HSBC. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question, sir. So I have one question, which is slightly on a medium-term basis. So of course, last week we all heard the news that Amazon is scouting for some distressed assets in India's cinema industry. Even in US also, there are similar news going on. So just want to understand from you how you think about a large international player with deep pocket and with connection to the entertainment industry entering in India, and how much it can change the industry structure. So how you think about this risk?
Well, again, I can, as I said for earlier questions, I think you should ask them that how they think about India and whatever the press reports were. So they are the right people to answer. But let me also tell you one thing, that when I talk about the Indian cinematographic landscape, we are a very underscreened nation. And today, what we are doing at INOX is we are trying to expand our footprint, because we all know that we have only 8 to 8.5 screens per million population. And if I talk about multiplexes, that's about 2.75 to 3 screens per million population. So we at INOX are growing. We are very bullish about this industry. We have got a very robust pipeline. And I always say that the Indian cinema industry is not going anywhere. It's a blip in a 100-year history, But otherwise, once things improve, we will be back to normal and with the usual hustle and bustle in our lobbies.
Just put it another way, I mean, what you all see as the barriers to entry in India multiplex industry?
What do you see? Could you repeat that, please?
So what you see as the key barriers to entry for a new player?
Well, for me, the barrier is the availability of real estate. That's a big barrier. Because today, when you look at various multiplex chains across the country, I think we have some great, good assets with us. The time it takes for a mall to come up in India and with all permissions and then cinemas to be constructed in it and then have permissions to operate the cinema takes a lot of time. So the biggest barrier I see is real estate. It also depends on how malls are shaping up in India. And let me tell you that we have some great malls which are being constructed and which will be operational in the next couple of years. So this, I would say, is a challenge because we all know that a mall and a multiplex have to coexist. They complement each other. So to have a successful mall or vice versa, it's nice that there's a multiplex in a mall because it adds value to the entire mall. It adds value to the other retailers. And also, it's good for a cinema operator to be a part of a mall as there are footfalls which are inherently there, which can be converted into cinema guests. So the biggest barrier, if I have to say in one word today, is the development of real estate in our country.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Sanjay Jain from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question. A couple of questions from my side. First, on the properties we have signed, that 926 properties which we expect to come over next few years, how should we see them? Will the rentals will be the same as what we are paying today, or will it have a more mix of revenue sharing in that? In that case, how should we see rental cost as a percentage of revenue going forward? Because our expectation was that if it's a fixed cost, as the occupancy goes up, we will have a benefit on the margin. Do you think that incrementally, as more and more mall or more and more screens come on a revenue sharing, that operating leverage to that extent will come down?
Well, Sanjay, it's too early to say that how do we treat those 926 screens that we have signed. But let me tell you, today our rentals are in the tune of 18-20% of the total revenues. Going forward, whether we have more properties signed on revenue share or a mix of revenue share and minimum guarantee or a fixed minimum guarantee is difficult to say. I would say that the entire company today has been battling how to survive this pandemic, how to still stay afloat, how to ensure that costs are reduced. And I think it will be some time before we visit the drawing board again and go through every property that we have signed and then decide the way forward. So it'll be too early for me to comment on that.
No, that's fine. Just one more question, probably a follow-up to that. One of your competitors said in the call that they're also looking out a model wherein some of the investment will come from the builders for the fit-outs as well, where they are going for a revenue sharing, which should make them more asset-light and where the capex intensity for the company would come down. Are we also in the mood to evaluate such kind of a model where we go more asset-light?
Well, we have a few properties already where the developer has put in money into our property. So that's not new for us. And we always encourage that because that reduces our capex cost. And the developer also wants us to be in his property, and that's why he does put in money. So we are already following with that pattern, and that's not new to us at all.
Okay. So you are telling this model is already in practice, but was it by design, or we want to pursue more this, or we are fine with whatever we are doing today?
No, absolutely. If we can have developers putting in money, why not? So we have had a few properties like this. We'll be talking to more developers going forward. And again, I said it's too early to see that how this pans out. But there are people or developers who want to partner with us, and they are more than willing to put in some money where CapEx is concerned.
Got it. Second, probably a question was earlier asked, but a small change there. How has been your discussion with the producers who have taken the movies directly to the OTT? Because they will be the probably the brand ambassador for that kind of a route. How have been their reaction internally? If you have heard anything, what are their experience going directly to the OTT? And how are the other producers perceiving it? Have we had any discussion around this which you can share with us?
Yes, Sanjesh, we speak with a lot of producers and distributors, but nobody has told us that what eyeballs that particular movie would garner. So, again, everybody was happy. I think that, remember one thing we have to understand, that the trend of a few movies which have gone on OTT is purely a result of the pandemic and the subsequent lockdown, and that's got nothing to do with the cinema's incapability to draw crowds. So that's how it is. We know that there are lots of producers, and I named all the movies, who are waiting to release their movies on the giant screen. Some of them, as I said, are even releasing the movies with 50% capacity restrictions across the country. Some of them are releasing movies without Maharashtra and without Tamil Nadu. So every producer to his or her own. But when we speak with various people, some, yes, have gone on the OTT platform. But what they are telling us, that for the other movies, they will come on the giant screen also. So it's neither, it can be both. Both could survive, Sanjesh. Okay. But how we have seen it, that the big marquee movies are waiting for theaters to open, because, as I said, that nothing gives more, I would say, kick to a producer and to talent than having people watching his movie on a dark screen, whistling, shouting, clapping. So watching a movie in India is a common experience, and that will never ever go away.
No, completely agree on that point. One follow-up here. Though it was a lockdown, I think shooting was permitted. So how are the movie production going on? Are we seeing the new lineup for a pipeline of movies, say, once this initial movie which are expected to go live, who are completed? How are you seeing, say, 6 months down the line? Will that pipeline remain equally robust for us to keep filling the screens?
Absolutely. The pipeline will be there. The movie, as you rightly said, the shooting has started with all safety protocols. So I do not see a time when there will be no movies hitting the screens on a Friday, out of question. Today, as we speak, we have got 25 films in Hindi, 25 in English, and an equal number in Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Bengali. And these are movies which are ready to be released. Going forward, as we said, the shooting has started, and I'm very sure that there will be lots of movies coming out on every Friday.
Okay, so we don't see a challenge even 6 months down the line on the movie pipeline. That remains crystal clear for us.
Yeah, not at all.
Got it. One last bit of question from my side. Assuming that we are hit by the third wave, it shouldn't happen, but the worst case basis, do we think we are adequately capitalized to sail through, say, another quarter or so of a shutdown, and we will not require any more capital infusion? We would look at a mix of debt, because we are a debt-free company. How should we see the capitalization part and, say, preparation for a worst-case scenario to play out for us?
Well, let me tell you that we are adequately capitalized. We have got a very strong liquidity position. And as we have shown in our presentation, that we have close to 400 crores, including undrawn limits, with us. So we can surely survive for, I would say, the entire financial year. If not more.
Got it. One just small question, assuming everything is fine in the second half, what kind of a capex should we build in for the second half? As we have projected another 10 screens to come out, what is that incremental capex means for us?
So 19 screens are nearly ready, anything between 8 to 10 crore rupees. And
okay.
If we take the fit out, and as I said earlier, depending on the flow of movies and the cash flows we have, we could take for fit out another 25 screens, and there the capex would be about 65 crores.
Got it. Yeah. That's it from my side. Thank you and best of luck.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, as this was the last question for the day, I would now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Well, I would like to thank everyone who took interest in our company and all those who are present on this call. And we assure you that we will ensure that we come back fitter and stronger, and we will wait to welcome all of you to our lobbies to watch a movie with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. On behalf of ICICI Securities Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.